everyone, and welcome to this T4D. Loads and bits of pieces I actually want to talk about. So for this session, I've actually got some pointers behind the camera so I don't forget a few bits and pieces that I want to mention. First of all, thanks to everyone who's actually put an entry into for the competition on the giveaway for the multimeter and for the voltage, the multimeter reference check. I really do appreciate seeing the photographs and what have you. I must say, if I could have a small giveaway for everyone who participated, I would. It's really great getting to see whether it's your neighborhood or your workbench or your favorite multimeter. As I say, it's just nice having that connection between the folks who are watching the videos. It's just nice having that kind of connection with you. Then I wanted to highlight a few bits and pieces which have come up. The one is also on the forum. Some interesting projects people are involved in which I did want to highlight. The one was from a good user and person on the forum, Kibby, who's started putting together an Arduino MPPT charge controller. And he's gone and documented with photographs his progress. He's gone from like a 16 by 2 line display LCD to a bigger display to actually putting together a circuit and producing a PCB, a circuit board for it. He's made mistakes along the way and he's documented them there, which I really appreciate, because guess what? It's the one way we actually learn, is by making mistakes along the way and trying to get around them. Often if you work on a project and it goes through fine, 100% no issues, yeah, it's great to have a great working end result, but you learn a lot more along the way by making mistakes. So certainly don't be ashamed of sharing your mistakes on projects that you're working on. I'm going to highlight even a few more of mine on the work I've been doing on even this multimeter reference check, but I'll highlight that later when we get to the bench and everything that's going on here. The other thing, there's a new user, or yes, in fact, a new subscriber who popped in onto the channel, Elia, I hope I pronounced that correctly, a 15-year-old from Frankfurt, Germany. And they've got a YouTube channel, not many videos up there, but they do have a blog, an electronics blog, because they're playing with, by all accounts, Arduino and robotics and all those kinds of things. And heavens, a brilliant little blog. I just wanted to highlight that. I think it's great that someone that young who's getting into electronics is actually documenting what they're doing that well. In fact, probably far better than what I'm doing. So I'll put a link to that down in the details below. I'm sure you may find something of interest, or it's just impressive to see someone that young jumping in and doing this kind of work and documenting it. I do enjoy highlighting people who are getting into the topic or hobby of electronics and are making a go of it. You don't have to be doing something fantastic, you can be doing something small, but you're just attempting something, and I think that's great. And if you know folks like that who have their own YouTube channels or blogs, let me know and I'll put references to them. I say, if you have a look at my homepage channel, I've got loads of links to other people's channels, and whether they've only got a few users or thousands of users, if there's something of interest and something that we can learn from, I'm going to post it there. Then the other thing is I've been playing around. I'm going to show you the voltage references I've been playing around, and the one question I want to ask is that I've been documenting and videoing the oven testing I've been doing on like the 10 volt references and the 5 volt references. There have been a few interesting results and like even failures with capacitors, which I don't fully understand yet. I haven't fully investigated, but I've made videos of that. If it's not going to bore you to tears, let me know and I'll put that video together just so you can see that. You will kind of see the end result as we have a closer look now when I show you what's happening on the bench at the moment. I kind of chuckle. The reason I did the video snip showing you all the multimeters at the beginning and what's happening. Last night I got to a fairly good point with the multimeter reference. I've got the prototype almost completely together, in essence together. I've had a few issues, which is why things are on test. Overnight I've been testing both the voltage references and the current reference. The current reference by all accounts, which I thought was going to be the most kind of touchy of all of them, is seems to be the most stable and spot on. That's why I was testing the two voltage references. I'm doing them all at the same time, which in essence you wouldn't do if you're going through the references. And it's probably not a good idea that, like, if you're taking the current reference and you're measuring the voltage reference at the same time, you're potentially going to upset things because they're not totally isolated. But in theory, they don't need to be isolated. I'm testing that now because you're going to be testing individually. But I found that running them off the two 9-volt batteries, there seemed to be a little bit of flutter on my measurement equipment on the least significant digits. That's why I powered it up to the power supply. And again, going back to why I've got all this here, someone posted a question. They obviously perhaps just jumped in and saw one of my videos, and they said, they saw the multimeters at the back, and they said, oh, do you just collect multimeters? Do you know how to use a multimeter, or do you use multimeters? And I kind of half chuckled at that, and I said, no, I do use multimeters. But, you know, to tell the truth, I obviously do a lot of multimeter reviews, and I use multimeters for measurements and logging. That's something I really like, is logging data, logging and collecting information. But there's probably a lot of you who know a lot more about using a multimeter than me. If you're using one daily for troubleshooting electrical or electronic stuff, you certainly know, get to know the ins and outs. And in fact, only now really, while I'm working putting the surface mount devices together and what have you, and having to test there, am I having to really put into practice the things that I kind of test and review and what have you, which is good for me. But so in essence, perhaps I'm certainly not the most accomplished multimeter user out there. But anyway, let's get into have a look what's on the bench, and I'll show you where we are and a few interesting, certainly perhaps an interesting discovery I made last night. Okay, so let me just do a quick spin around on the bits I'm measuring at the moment, and then we'll go into more a little bit more in-depth detail. So over there you'll see my Metrix is busy sitting away measuring something, and there's a power supply stuck behind it. It's actually measuring in the box. This is part of my kind of oven testing which I was recording. I've got the REF 5050 5-volt reference, which I was testing in the oven yesterday, and now I've kind of let it settle overnight to see how stable it would be. I had tantalum capacitors I was using, and I've had three of those fail. I say fail, but they would suddenly almost seem to perhaps short. I'm not sure what was going on, so I've gone to electrolytics, and the electrolytics have held out fine. So I basically left my Metrix overnight data logging to see how stable it would be. Then if we come round to the bench, what I've got happening, I've got my HP has been busy monitoring and data logging the 10 volt reference on the multimeter reference check. So I've actually almost got things together. On the back, I've got what I've decided to do, because of space and what have you, I'm going with three reference resistors as a reference, two voltage references, and one current. So in essence, it's going to be called, I don't know, something like the 3-2-1 gold standard multimeter reference check. Bit of a mouthful, but anyway. And then behind, you'll see I've got the references on the prototype board over there. And I say what I did, I had two 9-volt batteries connected up, and one of them might be slightly run down, but in theory this thing can run from as long as it's like 11-12 volts and above. But it seemed to be a little unstable, so I decided to connect it up to a power supply, and then overnight what I've done, I've got connections to all the references. So the HP's monitoring the 10 volt reference, my Isotec in the background there is monitoring the 5 volt reference. That's the REF 5050, but the it was the 8 parts per million. And in the testing, strangely enough, this 8 parts per million seemed to be more stable than the 2.5. So I don't know whether there was an issue with my testing or the flutter on the multimeter. But certainly overnight, if you're going to have a look at that figure, it's showing you the max minus the min. I'm doing a min-max recording. And the max minus the min is 0.002. So it's only been changed, it's only been fluttering on the last two digits, and that even there might be noise.
from the power supply or literally from the multimeter itself. Then over here I've got the Agilent, which is doing a min-max log of the current reference, and again that has proved to be actually a really stable current reference. And then over here I just have to wake it up, my Fluke 287 is monitoring another voltage reference. Now potentially this might be an interesting find. This voltage reference, I wanted to have another alternative and perhaps a more stable current reference here, just as a test, even though the one I've put together seems to work really well. So I found this is a voltage reference which has got a 5 parts per million temperature coefficient. I just have to turn around and look what it's called. It's the REF194EZ, and it's made by Analog Devices. And last night I was trying to put it together as a current reference, but I just wasn't getting it configured correctly. So I set it up as a voltage reference to ensure that it was working correctly. And I tell you, by all accounts, as a 4.5 volt voltage reference, it really seems to have been really, really stable. I'm going to check the data figures later, but that my Fluke 287 has been logging the results. I'm going to have a closer look at them, but literally it has been sitting, only the fourth digit has had some movement on it. I'm going to go through and look at the logged results. In fact, what I'll do is I'll switch the camera off and I'll stop this logging. We'll have a closer look just to confirm that. But that may end up being maybe even a replacement for the REF 5050. As I say, it's almost better to have something just under 5 volts as a reference, because then when testing something like a 287, which is a 50,000 count, if you go above 5 volts, you're going to drop a decimal place. So just under 5 volts, i.e. 4.5, means you've got better resolution against your reference. So I may actually end up using that if it does prove to be a really, really stable reference. So let's have a look at that now. Okay, so I hope I've got the lighting okay. There was a bit of reflection on the screen, and I've got the backlight on, but if that changes, we'll sort it out. So I've got it to trend the result, and down at the bottom of the screen here, you can see the actual voltage that's been recorded and the time. So I'm going to go back to when I started. Let's see, it was actually late last night. I was up until about 11:30, as I recall. So we go back to the beginning. So it was around 11 o'clock when I started the logging on this, and we can see it is 4.4998. And there goes 999. I mean, we can see from the line at the top, it's got a good steady line, but obviously that at the zoom in resolution on this log trend, I'm not going to see any blips. So I'm having a look along there, and this is for me the first time as well. So by all accounts, that looks like it has only changed 2 counts. Oh, there's a flip up there to just over 145001. So that looks like 3 counts on the fourth digit, which is absolutely incredible. Now I have to still put this into, I'm now actually going to test this as a voltage reference and put it into the oven to see how stable it is with temperature change. And I still have to get it connected up. I'm now really keen to see how well it works as a current reference as well. I am happy with the one I've got, but this could really prove to be a really, really good voltage reference and a current reference. Okay, and let's just have a quick look at the results that the HP3457 logged on the 10 volt reference. So here, the 10 volt reference, are you going to be able to see it? It is that little can over there, and as it so happened, I'll actually highlight a few failures I had. Let me actually bring that into view now before we have a look at the results here in my hands. Now these are the tantalum capacitors, which failed when I was doing the REF 5050 checks. I haven't actually checked to see if they're shorted or what's going on. They would kind of work. I saw overnight everything was fine, and then in the morning suddenly they would fail. The reference would go totally off, and it was drawing too much current. It would go from like a few milliamp to like 20. So I don't know whether these perhaps are shorting. It's something I still need to check. Also, this was the 10 volt reference I was going to use in the giveaway multimeter reference check. It was a, if I remember correctly, 15 parts per million 10 volt reference. And I was looking at the data sheet, and I was looking at it upside down the wrong way when I connected it. I connected it up the wrong way, dinged it. So it is dead. So I've gone and replaced it with a 10 volt reference, which is 5 parts per million. So to your benefit. Then also this, what was this? Oh, this was this was my 1 volt reference, which I still haven't tested yet. Well, you saw me when I did the surface mount soldering, I got it together and I got it running. And then when I came to connect it up, I've been testing everything at 12 volts. And all the other ICs and references have got a voltage range of, let's say, even up to 36 volts, at least 18 volts to 36 volts. And of course, this one doesn't, being so low. It's got a maximum input of 5 volts. And I went and switched it on 12 volts. So goodbye to that reference. So just a heads up, if you are doing these things, you need to kind of recheck and double check what your input tolerance levels are, because these certainly aren't cheap. We live and learn, but these aren't cheap. So let's go back. So that was the logging. I'm going to do some little fancy camera work on the tripod to get you up to the HP. And we're going to have a look at the HP. I've pulled up the memory. I've had it sat on its steadiest recording mode of 100, the number of power line cycles set to 100, so it really gives me an accurate reading. Now that's entry number one. It is actually logged, I had it logging every 2 minutes, so since last night it's logged 363. So what I want to see, I'm going to actually scroll through these, and what I'm looking for here is stability to at least the first three digits. If it has any flutter on the third one, I would count that as acceptable if it's one or two counts. But as I say, for this, the kind of gold standard reference, I want you to be able to use this to at least up to a 10,000 counts multimeter, potentially more, but I want kind of really robust accuracy up to a 10,000 count. So there, looking at those digits. So if we scroll through them, what I'm looking for is that third digit as we go through. Let's just check what number we're up to. 48. So I'm checking this for the first time, so I'm just keeping a hawk eye on what's happening on that digit. Okay, so I will have time-lapsed that so you didn't have to sit staring at that as I did, but that was perfect. It was certainly stable up to the third place, and in fact, just a little bit of flutter on the fourth digit. So I must say, I'm really happy with that. So again, whoever hopefully ends up with this reference should end up with really good, something really good. But what I also want to mention, what I plan to do, this, as I said, really is a rough prototype, which I'll be giving away. I also want to use it as a research effort as well. So what I plan to do, I obviously plan to improve the layout and the neatness of the front of the panel over time. I also plan to get a circuit board together for the back end. So when I give this away in its prototype slash rough format, what I will do is put the offer then, it's up to you to take it up, whoever wins this giveaway, is to return it to me after 12 months. And what I will do, at the very minimum, I'll check the calibration values to see whether it's still within tolerance for myself, my own research, and for you, and then send it back to you. If at that point in time I happen to have a nice, neater setup of this, then I'll send you one of those. If not, then I'd ask you to return it again after a year, by which time I certainly should have this together properly. And then I'll return a proper production version of this multimeter reference check. So whoever gets this, certainly, hopefully will have a nice device, which certainly for the next year, they will get a recalibration and then perhaps certainly an updated kind of finished product within the year.
Okay, so I hope you found that interesting. Certainly there is some really good progress. I'm happy with the progress that's being made on the multimeter reference check. As I said, the Fluke 8846A will be really helpful in that regard, because overnight I'd like two precision multimeters to be measuring references, and the 8846 has actually got some really nice trending and logging capability. Then also what I want to mention, I actually saw this posted in my forum just prior to popping out here and doing the video, so I haven't had time to reply yet. And this relates to the battery testing, that lead crystal battery that I received from Exolar. If you go to, and what put me onto this was, if you go to Dave Jones' EEV blog, he's recently just done a teardown of a BK Precision 8500 electronic load. Now, to tell you the truth, I hadn't realized such a device existed until recently. And Dave did the teardown, and my comment was, I'm really looking forward to a proper review on it, a full review. Because that kind of device, where you can actually program the amount of load that you need and get it to cycle through and test for, like solar panels, I often struggle with trying to get a constant load on a solar panel, the correct load. Or for instance, with the battery testing, you can preset a certain load that you want to test under, because you're obviously going to get different results depending on how you load the battery. It'll also then it's got a specific battery test where it'll give you the capacity of the battery. So it was Thomas, and his username is Tombs, in my forum posted saying, you know, surely you're missing out on this tool. And I can tell you now, don't I know it? I have done a fair bit of research, and I know the BK Precision 8500, the 300 watt, would be a really, really useful tool. At this point in time, although obviously this is in essence my daily job, my business, I have to be careful where I spend my money. So I can't justify at this point in time jumping out and getting one, although I know in the future I will. But so what I plan to do for the battery testing is put my own automated test system together. It may be a bit Heath Robinson, but what I'm planning to do is basically use my Metrix multimeter, which has got logging and can measure both current and voltage at the same time. I then plan to have a relay in place and a switch between a load and a charger after a certain time. So I'm gonna have to work out what time it takes to discharge the battery fully. Remember, I'm planning to try and kill this battery. Then to work out the time to actually charge it fully and have a timer which changes the relay with enough buffer each end, so obviously don't mess up the actual charge and discharge cycle. And all that will be logged to my Metrix, which I can then pull down to a PC, because it's going to take a fair amount of time even to get a few charge and discharge cycles through that battery. I know someone who communicates with me regularly has posted on my forum something similar to do with an Arduino project, which would kind of do the same thing, where you could do battery capacity testing and cycle it through a charge and discharge cycle, and the Arduino does the logging. Ultimately, that's what I'd like to build and put together. So that will happen in time to come, but I'll put something together for this initial test with the lead crystal battery, so look out for that. So again, I just want to thank all of you for your participation and your comments and what have you. And I will catch you soon for the first installment for the with the electronics tutorial. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon. Cheers.